Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's broadcast. Design, edit, analyze, and maximize your CRISPR-Cas9 editing efficiency. Presented by Dr. Kevin Holden, head of synthetic biology, Synthego. I'm Xavier Gutierrez of LabRoots, and I will be your moderator for today's event. We are delighted to bring you this educational web seminar presented by LabRoots and sponsored by Synthego. For more information about our sponsor, please visit www.synthego.com. Now, before we begin, I would like to remind everyone that this event is interactive. We encourage you to participate by submitting as many questions as you want, at any time you want, during the presentation. Just click on the Ask a Question box located on the far left of your screen and type your questions into the drop-down box that appears on the screen. Our speaker will respond to your questions via email. If you have trouble seeing or hearing the presentation, please click on the Ask a Question box to let us know that you're having a problem. This presentation is educational and thus offers continuing education credits. Please click on the Continuing Education Credits tab located in the top right corner of the presentation window and follow the process to obtain your credits. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Holden. I will now turn the presentation over to him.
Thank you, Xavier, for the introduction. So I'd like to start by telling you my title today for this webinar, which will be Design, Edit, Analyze, and Maximize Your CRISPR-Cas9 Editing Efficiency. So just to go through the schedule of this little online workshop we're gonna do, I'm gonna cover five main areas. The first is talking about how you design guide RNAs for doing CRISPR-Cas9 editing. The second will be how you can choose the right delivery method for delivering your CRISPR-Cas9 reagents to your cells. The third will be how we've developed some optimized methods for doing this and how you can also optimize your methodology as well. The fourth section will be about analyzing your CRISPR-Cas9 experimental data, and also isolating cells that you need to carry forward your experiments. And the last section, fifth section, will be about some online tools we developed, some services that we have as a company, and also a promotion for you to try out today. So let me start off by talking about how we design guide RNAs. And so what's really important when you're choosing how to design your guide RNA, really two key criteria. The first is, what is the format of the guide RNA that you should use? And the second is, where should you actually do this design? And so when we're talking about the guide RNA formats to use, at Synthego, we are a cell engineering company, and all of our projects involve the use of these chemically modified synthetic single guide RNAs that we use for generating indels, incels, knockouts, and knock-ins. We deliver these in the RNP format, which is the ribonucleoprotein complex, where essentially you're just complexing a purified Cas9 nuclease along with a synthetic single guide RNA in order to direct the nuclease to a specific location on the genome in order to initiate a double-stranded break and then a repair, which leads to a desired edit outcome. Why do we use these single guide RNAs in a chemically modified format? Well, several years ago now, there was a landmark paper that came out of Matthew Porteous's lab at Stanford University showing that you could utilize these chemically modified guide RNAs to effectively edit many different types of human primary cells, specifically in this case, primary human T cells and hematopoietic stem cells. And these chemical modifications that exist on the guide RNAs, they're important for several reasons. They actually are these 2'-O-methyl analogs and these sulfur interlinkages on the terminal three nucleotides on both ends of the guide RNA molecule. And these are important because they provide stability and protection from exonuclease inside the cell. We also see that they give overall improved editing rates in most cell lines, and particularly primary cells, as I mentioned. And this is because they prevent some of these innate immune cascades that can occur in primary cells that have been shown to be triggered by utilizing plasmid delivery systems or in vitro transcribed single guide RNAs. And some recent publications from the Jinsu Kim lab and also Jacob Korn's lab have documented this. It's important to note, like I mentioned, that if you're utilizing guide RNAs with that are derived from in vitro transcription or come from a plasmid, you cannot modify these. So your CRISPR-Cas9 editing rates will not be optimal. As a demonstration for this, I can tell you that sometimes if you unmodify single guide RNAs, they can perform very poorly in cell lines and primary cells. As an example here, we can see where we're looking at three different genes. We're trying to generate indels in exons in these three different genes. We're delivering the CRISPR-Cas9 components using the RMP format. This is into DIRCAT cells using electroporation, specifically nucleofection. And we're assaying for indel formation after several days. And you can see that in one of the genes, the RELA gene in the black in the graph here, that there's very little cutting activity. There's very little CRISPR-Cas9 activity. And when we have a modified version of the single guide RNA, we've completely recovered that cutting phenotype. And so the reason we think this occurs is because the modifications allow the guide RNA to persist a little longer in the cell, which allows the RMPs to access some of the sites that can be difficult to access, particularly in cell types like DIRCATs, where there's very strange karyotyping occurring and there can be bunching of the chromatin. So utilizing the chemically modified version of the single guides really does improve your indel frequencies. I mentioned that there are other ways to deliver CRISPR-Cas9 reagents into the cell, like a plasmid, for example. Some people also use lentivirus or Cas9 delivered as mRNA rather than nuclease. However, these have been shown to lead to increased off-target effects and accumulation of mutations through these formats. And this is just an image from a recent paper from Nature Methods showing that for these locations, you can see in blue, we're looking at an accumulation of mutations. And using the lentivirus approach, you can see, and the plasmid approach, you can see that you start to accumulate many more mutations in the cell. Compared to the RMP approach on the very left, we have the least amount of exogenous mutations. And this is because the RMP approach, the ribonuclear protein, is very transient inside of the cell. So you go in, you deliver this component, these components in this format, and very shortly they disappear and you don't get any residual cutting. And so with the lenti and the plasmid, you're getting a consistent constitutive expression of the reagents, and this can lead to undesired mutations. Okay, next I'm gonna talk about where you should actually go to design your guide RNAs. And so it really depends on the type of CRISPR-Cas9 edit that you're trying to do. If you're editing in exons and you'd like to generate a gene knockout, I'd recommend that you use a tool that we developed at Synthego. It's a gene knockout guide design tool that's very effective for picking optimal guide RNAs for exactly that purpose. If you're interested in editing intronic regions, maybe a UTR, or perhaps you're doing a homology-directed repair experiment where you actually want to program in a knock-in, such as a single nucleotide variant, I'd recommend using a DNA browsing software like the BenchLink tool. If you use the Synthego design tool for doing gene knockouts, it's a very simple interface that you can find on Synthego's website. Essentially, you enter your genome. This tool hosts over 100,000 genomes. You enter your gene name, and then you hit search. And what'll pop up is a map of the exon that you'd like to edit. If you're doing a gene knockout, it's best to target an exon that's early in the gene. And so this tool will rank the guide RNAs based on some scoring algorithms and recommend several that can be used directly to knock the gene out. Also, you can use this tool to validate any other guide RNAs that you may have designed on your own. And you can also see on the bottom here an extensive off-target analysis, which is important for understanding where else you may be targeting with this particular guide RNA. It is very important to choose an optimal guide RNA sequence. Many of the existing design tools rely on algorithms that were trained on large data sets using lentivirus or plasmid delivery, and that's how they developed their on-target score. On the right here, we can see a graph where we're comparing one of these on-target algorithms. And on the bottom, we're looking at the predicted editing efficiency from that algorithm. And on the left, we're looking on the left axis, we're looking at the observed editing efficiency using an RMP approach in these HEK293 cells. And what we can appreciate is that many of the guide RNAs that are predicted to be poor cutting, have poor activity, actually have very good activity when delivered in the RMP approach compared to the lenti approach that we'd use for these models. So in general, the on-target scoring that you get from these design tools is not particularly important. And so what is important is that you understand the genomic context of where you're editing in your cells. So it's important to use the resources that are available to understand your genomic landscape. For example, the genome browser hosted by UC Santa Cruz is a good way for understanding where you're editing, which transcript you're editing, if you're targeting link RNA or enhancer, for example. So we like to say that's more important than these on-target scores. When you do look at the off-target scores, again, it's important to use a design tool that helps you understand what these are. This is more of a concern if you're developing a therapeutic for gene therapies using CRISPR-Cas9. If you're simply generating a cell line, it may be less important. Typically, if you'd like to do a good off-target prediction, a good way to do this is to actually think about using a bioinformatics approach first, such as the COSMID tool, which is available online. In general, though, it's important to choose guide RNAs that have three mismatches or more in the target region, and this way you're less likely to off-target. At Synthego, we've also become very interested in understanding if we can actually predict CRISPR editing outcomes. And this has allowed us to build a more optimized design tool. So given a particular guide RNA sequence, can we actually predict the indel frequencies and the indel patterns that result from that guide RNA? And so we recently presented some of this data at the Cold Spring Harbor 2018 CRISPR-Cas9 conference, showing that using large sets of data, we can actually predict not only the CRISPR-Cas9 format, so the CRISPR-Cas9 indel frequency, but also the genotype of the sequence. And this is allowing us to develop more effective design tools that will also help you in your own research. Okay, we've talked a little bit about designing your guide RNAs and where a good place is to design them and some ideas about the best way to do that. Now let's talk about some delivery methods. So the most important thing to consider is how should I actually transfect my cells with CRISPR-Cas9 reagents? And so effectively, there really are three really good ways of doing this when it comes to using the RMP approach. The first is to use a lipofectamine type reagent, such as the CRISPR-Max reagent. And this is okay for most cell lines. Perhaps a better option is to use an electroporation system, like the thermoneon system, which is good for cell lines and also primary cells. Even better than that, and what we use at Synthego, is the Lonza nuclear effector system, which we find provides really superior editing in many cell lines and also primary cells. And this has to do with the optimization of electroporation solutions and also the electroporation programs that are used in this format. Transfection technique can affect your editing outcomes. And what we're looking at in this graph is we're looking at several guide RNAs that are being scanned across several different genes here. And on the left, we're looking at using a CRISPR-Max delivery, using lipofectamine to deliver the RMPs into the cell. And on the right, we can see the same RMPs are being delivered using nucleofection. And what you can appreciate is the indel efficiencies, the editing efficiencies are much more effective using the nucleofection format. However, if you do have to use a lipofectamine reagent, I can tell you that there are several different ways of doing this. And really the best way to do it is using what we call a reverse transfection technique. So before applying the lipofectamine and the RMPs for your CRISPR-Cas9 editing, it's important to trypsinize your cells first. And you can see on the left that for this control guide, guide RNA, that switching to a reverse transcription, reverse transfection methodology can really improve your editing efficiency. And this is true on the right, you can see in several different cell lines. But it's important to note that when you're switching between cell lines, you can't always plug and play your CRISPR-Cas9 method. So you may need to re-optimize based on the cell line that, that you're using. So although some of these kits, particularly also for electroporation, can have cross-cell type functionality, it's important to really optimize the electroporation buffers and pulses for each cell type. And so, like I mentioned, switching between cell types, and particularly from a cell line into a primary cell, what you find works in one cell may not work in the other. And this leads us into our next section on optimized methods. And so it's really important every time that you're working with a new cell line or a new type of primary cell to really optimize how you deliver your CRISPR-Cas9 reagents. Of particular importance is the ratio of the guide RNA to the Cas9. And so here we're looking at several graphs where we've tried to optimize the best RMP ratio for editing in a particular cell line. In this particular case, HEK293 cells. And you can see that just using a simple one-to-one ratio on the very left actually gives you very poor editing efficiencies. And so previously, this has actually been reported by several groups as kind of the way to go. But as you can see here, going upwards towards maybe like a 5-to-1 or a 9-to-1 ratio or somewhere in between there, where you use excess of the guide RNA, really does give you a much more optimized editing efficiency. And this bears true through many different targets. Once you hit this kind of optimal number, it really will hold true for that cell type. It's also important when you're looking for activity with your RMPs and your your single guide RNAs, that you actually screen multiple guides. In this particular example here, and this is data we generated in collaboration with Matthew Porteous's lab at Stanford University, we're looking at different single guide RNAs that we can utilize to knock out a protein that's on the cell surface of primary T cells. And so here we've actually screened through six different guide RNAs, all located at a very early location within an exon. And so what's important here and what you can appreciate is that some of these guides just will cut more effectively than others. And looking at guide number six, we just don't see much activity at all. So every time that you're kind of going through and you'd like to knock out a gene, it's important to first kind of assay the activity of these guide RNAs, utilizing several of these at once in order to really pick the best one that can give you the best chance of generating a knockout. And so when we're doing this and we're utilizing CRISPR-Cas9, to make an indel in an early exon, what we're looking for are the formation of indels that can generate a frame shift, and this can cause a knockout. So indels that are non-derivative of 3. So in this particular case, again, it's important to screen several guides. And it could be that guide RNA number 6 here has a lot of activity in terms of generating large numbers of indels, insertions and deletions in the repair, but it could be that they're all none of these are generating a frameshift sufficient for knockout, because here we're measuring knockout through FACS analysis and looking for essentially the disappearance of that cell surface receptor protein on the T cell. Another way to validate if you're generating a knockout is to have a phenotypic test. So this could be something as easy as doing a Western blot. In this particular example here, what we're looking at is we're trying to develop a nice assay to produce a strong phenotype that demonstrates a good gene knockout. For this experiment, we utilize these mouse C2, C12 myoblast cells. and left alone, these self-differentiate from myoblasts into what are called myotubes, which is like a muscle-type fiber. And this is controlled through a process of differentiation that is regulated by a gene called MyoD1. So here we asked our design tool to select several guide RNAs, and it picked four guide RNAs. And we went through and we assayed these RNAs. And this is for knocking out the MyoD1 gene in these mouse C2C12 myoblasts. So on the bottom right, you can see that we assayed these guide RNAs and looked for indel frequency. And we found one that we really liked, the third from the left, gave a very strong indel frequency. So that's the one we went ahead and tested. And you can see here, compared to culture day zero on the left, 4 days after differentiation, if the cells did not get any guide RNA, the control in the center, they formed the myotubes. But if they did receive that strong guide RNA cutter that we saw, we can see that they're not differentiating. So we're essentially causing a knockout of that gene, and we're seeing that phenotypically here, which is a good validation. It's important also to understand what your actual knockout percentage is. So I mentioned that you can form indels at a very high rate, but some of these indels may not cause a frameshift because they may be derivatives of three. So in this particular case here, we're looking at three different separate gene knockouts, and the indel rates are quite high for all of these. The knockout rates are a little bit different because the knockout score here we're calculating are the percentage of these indels that can cause a actual frameshift. So again, non-derivatives of three. And so here we're just looking at some Western blots in order to validate that we're getting a gene knockout in these three particular genes here. So, you know, as a way to validate something like a gene knockout using CRISPR-Cas9, it's important to be able to test them phenotypically. If you have trouble generating a knockout using a single guide RNA, just one guide in an early exon in your gene, there are some other approaches you can utilize to kind of maximize knockout efficiency. So one way to do this is to actually multiplex several local guide RNAs together in order to generate what we call a dropout. So when you get a dropout like this, you're much more likely to actually cause a genotypic and phenotypic knockout. And we can see here, looking on the left, that when you combine several guide RNAs together, on the very left, you can see that there's actually a synergistic approach in terms of how much total indels that you can form. So three of those guide RNAs are not performing all that fantastically, but together you've essentially recovered that phenotype. And if you have three that are actually working very good, mixing them together doesn't cause any harm. And so here we can see that this works on a small scale, but when you also apply this to many different guide RNAs, you can see that the overall is an additive effect. And another way of looking at this, here we're looking at over 100 different random genes where we've multiplexed guide RNAs together. And you can appreciate that multiplexing these together, again, in the RMP format, you can see that you really can drive up that indel frequency. And so there are very few that actually work better on their own than they do when they're combined with several different guide RNAs. And another way of looking at this, here we're on the left, we're looking at a spread here of guide RNAs, and then we're correlating these single guide RNA activities to the multiplex format. And what's really important when we look at these 60 different random genes here is not just looking at that indel frequency, but also that knockout score, because like I mentioned, some indels cannot form frameshifts. And here we're seeing that this is actually a wide range here in these indels. And so really mixing three of these guide RNAs together in the multiplex format can give you the strongest possibility of getting a knockout score. In this particular experiment, we saw that using the multiplex format gave us an 88% likelihood of getting a knockout compared to just 33% using a single guide. Another example here I'd like to walk you through is the optimization of using CRISPR-Cas9 in primary cells. And in this particular case, we're going to be talking about an iPSC line, so an induced pluripotent stem cell line. This particular stem cell line we use is called PGP1. It's very well characterized and originates from the George Church lab at MIT. And so iPSC is a very powerful tool in research for several reasons. One is that they can be used to generate disease models or to functional studies or even drug screening, essentially by reprogramming these stem cells once edited and differentiating them into a particular cell type. There's also some potential therapies that can be utilized from working with iPSCs. And so this is also important as well. And so what we wanted to do when we took in this iPSC line, we wanted to optimize our transfection capability. So we used a control guide RNA that we know works and we know that it cuts very effectively. And in this particular case, we're looking at several different nucleofection programs that have been recommended by the manufacturer of the nucleofection device, Lonza. And we're comparing them in different well formats, either a 24-well plate or 96-well plate. And what we can see here is that using different electroporation conditions, while we don't see any differences in viability, we can see differences in proliferation. And particularly, we can see some marked difference in actually the indel frequencies that you can get depending on the number of cells you're using and also the program that you're using as well. And so in this case, we actually did a very large experiment where we looked at a wide range of cell numbers. We looked at different ratios of the RMP. Like I mentioned, that's an important factor when you're doing these CRISPR-Cas9 optimizations. And we found several things. The first is here we're looking at the cell number, and we're comparing two versions of the cell line, one that we obtained from the Church lab and one that the same cell line that we obtained from a commercial source. We can see that in general, there's really no difference working in the number of cells here and the source of the cell line. So that part of the optimization wasn't too important. And here we can see, if we actually look at the cell number, we don't see a much difference either as well. But what we did find was important in this particular example was, again, the RMP ratio, so the ratio of the guide RNA to the CRISPR-Cas9. And we can see, if you look on the very left of this graph, a 1-to-1 ratio did not give very effective editing. In this particular example, a 5-to-1 ratio was most promising for working in the cell line. And so this is different from when we use, for example, a primary T cell or a particular cell line, which may have a very different RMP ratio. And so these are likely different because different cell types have different abilities to break down the RNA and the nuclease inside their nucleus and also inside the cell. Here we're looking at a different optimization experiment we did where we wanted to optimize knock-in efficiency. And so in this particular experiment, we're looking to generate a single nucleotide variant, so an SNV or a SNP. We're varying several different parameters here. We're supplying a piece of donor DNA in order to make this change. So we're driving the CRISPR-Cas9 repair towards the HDR or homology-directed repair pathway away from the indel NHEJ non-homologous end-joining pathway. And so we're doing this because we want to essentially model a disease and make a disease mutation using a single nucleotide variant. And so here we're varying the actual length of the homology arms that you use for knocking in this donor DNA. I should mention that this donor DNA is a single-stranded piece of DNA, very akin to a single-stranded oligonucleotide, like a primer almost. And so, and these are typically 100 nucleotides in total length. That's what we're working with here for doing a single nucleotide variant. And so we're also varying the orientation of the donor. So are we supplying that single-stranded DNA on the same strand that our single guide RNA is targeting or on the non-targeting strand? And we're also looking at symmetry of the donor. So do we have symmetrical homology arms, 50 nucleotides either side, or are we kind of shifting one way or the other? And so we found some interesting things here. Here we're looking at the total editing efficiency, and this is in a HEK 293 cell line. We're looking at the ratios of homology-directed repair versus non-homologous end-joining in red here. And so what we're looking at here is we can see either T for targeting strand or NT for non-targeting strand, and the numbers represent the amount of donor DNA that we're utilizing. A little better way to look at this is, and also to look at the symmetry, is here we can actually see that on the top, where we have symmetrical arms, we're really not seeing a major difference compared to if we're using asymmetrical arms. So in fact, sometimes it can be a little bit better. Here we're seeing that it seems to make a difference if we're targeting the targeting strand with our single-stranded piece of DNA. In other experiments, since this, we found that maybe this doesn't matter so much. But in general, what we're finding is using symmetrical arms that are equal for homology, and also targeting the targeting strands seems to always work the best. So that's typically what we do for our cell engineering projects at Synthego. And so to kind of sum up how you optimize your CRISPR-Cas9 editing using your reagents, this is what we like to call state-of-the-art for doing CRISPR-Cas9 editing using RMPs. So we're typically using purified wild-type Cas9. For these, we source it from a company called Aldevron. We also can provide this. We're using the chemically modified synthetic guide RNAs. Like I mentioned, we're using RMP format, and we're electroporating these using something like a nucleofection. Again, you can also use lipofectamine, but you just won't see as high editing. We're making sure that our guide design is good. So if we're trying to do a gene knockout, we're targeting an early exon or perhaps even a splice site. We're making sure that we have low off-target effects by making sure we have more than 3 mismatches in our 20 nucleotide target sequence. And we're doing an accurate CRISPR analysis, either using something like NGS, digital droplet PCR, or a tool we developed called called ICE. For doing the knock-ins, we're using pure single-stranded DNA. We're not modifying these in any way. Again, you can target any strand. We tend to target the targeting strand a little more. We find that using symmetric homology arms works the best, particularly if you're trying to do a simple knock-in like a gene tag or a single nucleotide variant. And these are typically 100 to 150 nucleotides in length. It's also important, and something I didn't mention yet, is to actually try to remove the PAM sequence. So in CRISPR-Cas9, you'll be aware that following the guide RNA, there has to be an NGG PAM sequence. And so it really is important to kind of program into your donor DNA fragment a silent mutation that can alter this PAM sequence and destroy it. That way, when you are getting a successful knock-in, you're being certain not to recut the same genomic region over and over again. And this can really drive up your knock-in rates. And so using all of these, this format and all of these kind of guidelines, we find it's very easy to get very high indel rates in most cell lines and also primary cells, up to 90% with a good guide, sometimes even higher. We get very high knock-in efficiencies, sometimes up to 50% for inserts that are small, like gene tags or single nucleotide variants. And we get very low overall off-target rates, somewhere close to 1% to 2%. Okay, I've talked a little bit about optimization, and so I'd like to talk a little bit more about how we actually analyze CRISPR-Cas9 edits. And so at Synthego, we had seen that there were some existing tools for analyzing CRISPR-Cas9 edits, but we were very interested in understanding how we could do this very quickly, several days after transfection in a pool of cells. We do cell engineering projects, so we're doing CRISPR in high throughput. So we want to understand how can we analyze these edits very quickly, and also how can we analyze complicated scenarios like using the multiplex format of several guides at once, like I mentioned earlier. So we developed a tool that we call ICE, which stands for Inference of CRISPR Edits. And so just to kind of remind you, what we're doing every time that we analyze our CRISPR experiment is we're doing a PCR amplification of the region that we're trying to edit. We're generating Sanger sequencing data, which can be generated very quickly, typically in a day. And both our control population of cells, so this is cells that have been not edited at all, and also our edited CRISPR-Cas9 edited pools of cells. And so this is a free web tool that's available online, and you can just go to ice.synthego.com, and you can drag and drop your single Sanger sequencing API files directly into this tool, either one at a time, Or you can actually batch upload these. And the tool allows you to batch upload up to 700 samples at a time, which is really useful for doing high throughput editing, perhaps in a 96 well format or 384 well format. And what you get out of this tool is you'll see that you can visualize a essentially an indol spread. So you'll see on the left here, a graph that basically is visualizing the pattern of indels that you get from generating this double-stranded break. And so on the top of the screen, you can also see that you get a I-score, which is your total indel frequency score. And also on the right, you can see that knockout score that I mentioned earlier. We're actually seeing the percentage of indels that are capable of causing a frameshift. You also get a nice alignment of your sequences. And most importantly, you get a detailed analysis of the actual genotypes that are deconvoluted from your mixed Sanger peaks in your CRISPR-Cas9 edited population. And this is really important because here you can see that there are actually two different genotypes for a minus one insertion where a deletion, excuse me. So you essentially chewed back, the cell is chewed back on either side of that CRISPR-Cas9 cut site. And just looking at the indol patterns, you wouldn't be able to tell that unless you actually look at these genotype patterns. And this can also be used for analyzing multiple guides at once. In this particular example, we're looking at using two guide RNAs at once to form a dropout. Here we're looking at minus 40 dropout. And also you can use it to analyze three guide RNAs at once as well. And so here we're looking at a much larger dropout using three guides that are multiplexed together in a local region, typically somewhere in the region of 200 nucleotides in that neighborhood. This tool is also capable of generating knock-in scores as well. So this is actually coming in a coming release, which will should be released toward the end of October 2018, that shows that you can do homology-directed repair editing analysis as well, which is going to be very useful. Again, I mentioned this tool is free to use. It's at ice.synthego.com, and it really is the easiest way to analyze your CRISPR-Cas9 editing using something that's very inexpensive, like Sanger sequencing. And you can get it back literally the next day. If you'd like to read a little bit more about this, we actually submitted a paper to the bioarchive that demonstrates exactly how this tool works and how the algorithm was developed. Okay, so just to wrap up this section, I'd like to talk a little bit about how you can isolate your CRISPR-Cas9 edited cells. So this whole time I've been talking about generating these very high indol rates. And so if you can generate high indol rates or high knock-in rates, then you actually don't have to use any selection when you're trying to isolate clones that have the specific CRISPR-Cas9 edit that you want. So on our website, if you go to synthego.com/resources, we actually have some protocols that can teach you how to effectively isolate clones using limiting dilution and not having to use any selection markers or antibiotics. And so really the key take-home point here, though, is if you have high editing efficiencies, you can see on the right, you end up having to screen a lot less wells in order to find a clone. If you have low editing efficiencies, then you're just going to spend a really long time trying to identify a clone, and you really wouldn't want to screen through 343 wells at once. Another approach is to also use, particularly if you're doing a knock-in clone and you have lower efficiencies, is actually consider using a tool like OutKnocker, where you can upload next-generation sequencing data directly, and it will actually call out, in this particular case, we're looking at a copy of a cell culture plate, it actually will call out the actual specific genotype in each well that allows you to really go back and find the wells where you can isolate clones much more easily. So depending on if you're just doing a straight indel and forming a knockout, or if you're doing a knock-in, may inform you on what kind of tool that you'd like to use. Okay, so we've gone through how you design your guides, how you can deliver the reagents into your cells for doing CRISPR-Cas9 editing, how you might want to optimize doing that for your particular cell line or cell type, and the kind of optimized methods that we're using here at Synthego, and also how you can analyze and isolate your cells after doing CRISPR-Cas9 editing. And so just to wrap up, I'd like to talk a little bit about some tools, services, and a giveaway that we have. And so all of the tools I mentioned earlier, the design tool, verifying your guide design, or doing the ICE CRISPR editing analysis, are freely available at tools.synthego.com. We also have protocols actually as well on a resources page for doing nucleofection or for using the lipofectamine approach, and also isolating your clones. And I should mention that as a company, Synthego can also CRISPR-Cas9 engineer your cells for you. So rather than, if you're new to the CRISPR game, or perhaps you have a cell line that's very challenging for you to work with, maybe you don't want to spend a lot of your time developing these CRISPR methods in your lab and doing all the optimization. We can actually optimize CRISPR methods in any cell line very quickly and very effectively. And this is because we synthesize all of our own materials for doing CRISPR-Cas9. We have an automated cell engineering platform that really allows us to optimize cell lines and primary cells very quickly. We kind of layer in some computational biology and the learning, like I showed you before, how we can actually predict what indels will form on the genotypic level. And so this makes it very fast and inexpensive for us to do CRISPR-Cas9 cell engineering. And just as an example, here we took in these THP1 cells that can be quite challenging to work with. And when we use the recommended protocol from the electroporation manufacturer's website, we only were getting 7% editing efficiency. But we run it through an automated process where, in high throughput, we can do CRISPR-Cas9 optimization in the cell line, varying many different variables, like I mentioned before, like the number of cells, the pulses you're using in the electroporation conditions, or the types of media, or even which part of the cell cycle you might be really hitting these cells at. And so when we optimized this, we found we could actually shift this up all the way up to 82% editing efficiency. And this really allows us to very quickly do CRISPR-Cas9 editing and to isolate cells very quickly. And so we've actually produced a suite of services that can help you do CRISPR-Cas9 editing. If you don't want to do the optimization and learn all the methodologies on your own, that's okay. We can actually deliver CRISPR-Cas9 engineered cells directly to your lab, either as pools of cells where we generated a knockout pool of cells that have a very high knockout percentage. This allows you to either directly use the cell in your screen or assay, or to very easily isolate a clone. And these are delivered in just 4 weeks. Or we can actually give you a clonal line of cells as well, where we actually will 100% verify a knockout clone. And this takes as little as 8 weeks. Or we can actually do any cell line or any edit, including knock-ins, using this advanced cell platform. And so the first two I mentioned are actually what we call a cloud biology lab solution, where you can actually go directly onto the website, just enter your actual gene you want to edit, and then, or you want to knock out, and then you just hit go, and essentially we will do all the work, and within several weeks you'll just get knockout cell pools or knockout clones delivered directly to your lab, and you don't have to do anything else. And we'll give you a complete report of the genotypes of the cells that you're getting, and all of the work that we did along the way. Okay, just to kind of wrap up, I'd also like to let you know about a promotion if you do want to do the CRISPR-Cas9 editing on your own, and I highly recommend that too. You can actually try these chemically modified synthetic sgRNAs for free. You can get three of them for free. Just go to synthego.com/free, and again, feel free to use any of the resources available on our website, the protocols, or the recommendations that I've actually put into this presentation today. So thank you so much for your time. If you have any questions, you can feel free to reach out to us directly. I have my email address here. I believe there's going to be a Q&A at the end of this webinar where you can also submit questions, which will get fed directly to me. We also have a support channel at Synthego as well. Again, the tools I mentioned are at tools.synthego.com, the free online tools. You can utilize our resources, try the single guide RNAs for free, or if you're interested in actually getting cells delivered to you directly, you can check out synthego.com/cells. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your time and your attention today, and I look forward to all of your questions. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Holden, for that informative presentation. We will now start the Q&A portion of the webinar and will address some of the most commonly asked questions by our viewers. If you have any questions you'd like to ask, please do so now. Just click on the Ask a Question drop-down box located on the far left of your presentation window. Type your question into the box that appears on your screen and click the Send button. Our speaker will follow up with your questions via email. And let's get started. Our first question is, for knock-ins, do you recommend ssDNA donors that align to the targeting of or non-targeting strand of the sgRNA?
So this is something that I went through a little bit in the presentation, and it's a little bit ambiguous. So, we have found in other experiments that it really didn't matter too much if we were targeting the non-targeting strand or the targeting strand where your guide RNA cuts. So it seems to work in both ways. In general, for kind of ease of design and quickness of design, we typically just use the targeting strand. So that way we can very easily in an automated process, design both the guide RNA and the single-stranded donor, just kind of by looking at it very easily. And this will probably help you as well. So I would say not to really worry about that and let it overcomplicate your experiment. And so using the targeting strand is just fine. Some recent publications have shown that the repair mechanism actually isn't really through what we call homology-directed repair. It's much more likely to be through SSTR, which is single-stranded template repair. So this template they're using actually itself is not getting incorporated into the genome. It's just being used as a template. So again, the repair mechanism can work on either strand, so it's not that important. For ease of design, I would use the targeting strand.
And what design tool would you recommend for designing guide RNAs?
So like I mentioned, we have this design tool for doing gene knockouts. I think if you're doing a gene knockout and it's a simple experiment like that, you're trying to form an indel, and you're focused on just doing a knockout, I would use the tool that we have available because it really gives you a good visualization of everything you want to look at. If you're doing edits in other regions, maybe you're not trying to target a specific early exon to do a gene knockout. Maybe you want to generate a single nucleotide variant somewhere else in the gene. Maybe you want to do indels in a UTR region. Or if you're doing a knock-in, I would recommend using a DNA browser tool like Benchling or Genius. And this will really give you a better visualization of where you can actually see all of the guide RNAs as well. So it really is dependent on your application. If you're doing a simple knockout, I would just use a simple tool like the knockout design tool we have. If it's more complicated, definitely use a DNA browser tool like the Benchling tool. It's very good.
We have time for one more question. How can I get more information about Synthego's engineered cells?
I kind of touched on those a little briefly, but again, if you go to the website, synthego.com/cells, you can learn a little bit about how we work with cell engineering, how we optimize cell lines, what kind of cell products we can deliver, whether it's one of the knockout pools or maybe it's one of a clone or a specific knock-in project. So we can actually take in any customer cell line. I think on our website, we host over 700 different cell lines that you can use to do gene knockouts or even knock-ins as well. Just go to the website, check out synthego.com/cells, and that's really the best way to get all the information you need. And if you have any questions, there's live chat available, or you can send us an email. We'll get back to you very shortly.
Well, I would like to once again thank Dr. Holden for his presentation. And I would also like to thank Synthego for making today's educational webcast possible. Before we go, I want to let everyone know that today's webcast will be available for on-demand viewing through January of 2019. You will receive an email from LabRoots letting you know when this webcast will be available for replay. Please share that announcement with your colleagues who may have missed today's event. That's all for now. Thank you for joining us, and we hope to see you again soon. Goodbye.